Hello students, today we are going to talk about new topic, new chapter we will be starting, and that is light. So I'll just write the name of the lesson, light. Now this word light is not new for us. Definitely we will be studying certain new concepts of light in this chapter, but still if we talk randomly, you know, just in general, light, the word light, it itself, this word itself brings lot of meaning to us, because we all know that we are able to see this beautiful world just because of the light. I know, and we all know that in this you know, in this thing that we are seeing this beautiful world, our eyes plays very important role. But along with eyes, just imagine if there is no light, there is absolute darkness, will we be able to see? No, we won't be able to see. So light is important for us, it's very very important for us, because we are able to see the different objects which are present in front of us just because of light. So let's talk about this topic now. When we start, when we have to start the topic, the first thing which comes in our mind, that what are the things which we are able to see? We are able to see whatever which is around us. We can see, at present I'm able to see chalk, duster, blackboard, many things. If we go out, we can see trees and beauty of nature, sky, birds. So why does it happen? Why are we able to see? What actually is happening? So first of all, I would like to say that there are two kinds of object. We can divide the object into two categories: luminous object and non-luminous object. Luminous object and non-luminous object. Now, what is the meaning of luminous object? Luminous object means those objects which emits their own light. Objects which emits, I have not taken white chalk. So objects which emits their own light. What is the meaning of luminous object? Those objects which are capable of emitting their own light. Now, if we talk about the examples of luminous object, we all know sun is the biggest luminous object. We are able to see in daytime just because of the presence of the sun, and this is the reason why we are, you know, there are plenty of reasons like why we are able to that is the reason, in presence of sunlight we are able to see. But the question again remains there only, that how are we able to see? See what actually happens. Now when we talk about the sun or any artificial luminous object, maybe tube light or bulb or torch, we take the example of any luminous object, whether it is natural or artificial. What actually happens, you know, when these object emits light, these rays, you know, the light when it is emitted, it get reflected back from the surface and it comes back in, at it comes in our eyes, and that is the reason we are able to see the things. But when we talk about luminous object, there are only very few objects which emit their own light, very few. But at the same time, when we talk about the non-luminous object, there are n number of examples which we can quote for non-luminous object. How can we define non-luminous object? Objects which do not emit their light. Objects which do not emit their light, they do not have any kind of light. But then how we are able to see? Now here take the example of the moon. Even moon is a non-luminous object. Take book, chalk, chair. There are many examples which we can write over here. So how can we see these objects when they are not emitting their light? How are we able to see all these different objects which are present around us even though they are not emitting any kind of light? So actually, now what is happening? Now if we talk about any luminous object, take the example of the sun. Now when the sun's light fall on any object, when it falls on any object, say for example it is falling on a tree, or grass or something like that, when it is falling on this, sun rays are falling on these or at least over here this plant or maybe the flower or the grass. Now when it is falling over here, then what is actually happening? Now it's falling here on this plant. After it reaches, these rays are falling here. Now these rays, when it fall on the surface of the plant, it gets scattered, you know, it gets scattered in all the directions. Now see, I have made an arrow over here that these rays are coming from the sun. These rays get, you know, they turn back and they get scattered in all different directions. And when these rays which are reflected back, it reaches our eyes. We will be able to see. When it reaches the eyes, then the person is able to see. So what actually is happening, children? We are talking about that how is it possible, how what is there, how we are able to see. So we can divide the objects into two categories: luminous objects and non-luminous object. Luminous objects are the one which emit their own light, but non-luminous object are the one which do not have any light, you know, they do not emit any kind of light. But here we can understand that they have their own light and they are emitting light continuously. But how we are able to see all these objects? So what is happening when the luminous object, emits light on any other body which is non-luminous, then what happens? This rays of light gets spread in all different directions. It is getting reflected in all different directions. And when these reflected rays reaches our eyes, we are able to see that particular object. If we talk about moon, why we are able to see moon? Moon is also a non-luminous body. But what is happening? Due to the light of the sun which is reaching the surface of the moon, it gets reflected back from the moon. What I am saying, that sun's rays reaches the surface of the moon. Now this is moon. Now from here the sun rays reaches the surface of the moon, and it again, when it reaches the surface of the moon, what is happening? It is getting reflected, and when this reflected rays reaches our eyes, we are able to see moon. So one thing is very clear, that why are we able to see the objects? We are able to see the objects because when light falls on them, it gets scattered in different directions and it reaches our eyes, and so we are able to see the different objects which are around us. Now we'll talk about the nature of light. Nature of light. If we talk about the nature of light, two kind of theories are being given for the explanation of nature of light. The first theory is wave theory. The first theory is wave theory, and this theory says that light, what is light? That light moves in the form of the waves. Light moves in the form of the electromagnetic waves. So light, this theory says light moves in the form of electromagnetic waves. What it is saying, this theory, what does it, this theory says, it is wave theory of light, and it says, now we know that why are we able to see the different objects. So now we'll talk about the nature of light. Next, now we'll be talking about nature of light. Now, what is the nature of light? How the nature of light is. So to explain the nature of light, two theories were given. To explain the nature of light, two theories were given, and the first theory is wave theory. The first theory is wave theory. Now what does this wave theory says? This wave theory says that light is composed of waves. Light is composed of electromagnetic waves, and this light doesn't need medium to travel. So what does this theory says? That light is composed of electromagnetic waves and it does not require medium to travel, does not require medium to travel. Now, what does this theory says? That light is composed of waves. Which kind of waves, children? It is composed of electromagnetic waves, and it does not need any kind of medium to travel. Before studying light, we have already discussed the chapter sound. And in that chapter, we have studied that what is the meaning of medium, and we have also studied that sound needs medium to travel. Sound cannot travel, it cannot reach to our ears. We won't be able to get the sensation of hearing until unless the medium is there. It can be solid, liquid or gas, and definitely the speed of sound changes with the medium. But it is not the case for the light. the wave theory explains that light doesn't need medium to travel. You know, with the help of these this theory, certain phenomena can be explained, and the phenomena which can be explained by this theory are diffraction and even polarization. Now, we will be talking about now the second theory, which is known as particle theory. Now, the second theory is known as particle theory. Particle theory. Now, what does this particle theory suggest? The particle theory says that light is composed of particles. See, the first theory says that light is composed of waves. But particle theory says that light is composed of particles. Light is composed of particles which travels in a straight line with a great speed. It travels in a straight line with a great speed, with a very high speed. So, what is particle theory saying? It is saying that light is composed of very small particles, and light travels with a very high speed, and it always travels in a straight line. And if you remember, this we have read in 7th standard that what this is known as the light always travels in a straight line. This is known as rectilinear propagation of light. It is known as rectilinear propagation of light. Now, rectilinear propagation of light says that light always travels in a straight direction. What is the reason of the shadows to be formed? Why shadows are formed, children? Shadows are formed always when the light get obstructed. Now, see, from the in front of the board, from the opposite side, if light is focused on the board, it will move in a straight line. But now, as of here, a big obstacle is there, blackboard is there, and this blackboard is opaque. Opaque means what? Transparent means it can move to the other side. Translucent means it will move, but not completely, it won't move to the other side. Opaque means light won't be allowed to move to the other side. It will come back. It will come back. So, that is the reason why shadow is formed, because light cannot move across this, as this object is opaque. It doesn't allow the light to move to the other, it doesn't allow the light to move on the other side, and so the shadow is formed. Now, this particle theory is also capable to explain few phenomena like refraction and reflection. Can be explained when we consider that light travels light is composed of particles and it travels in a straight line. When we consider the particle theory of light, certain phenomena can be explained on the basis of particle theory. Now, what, children? If we talk about wave theory, certain theories, certain phenomena can be explained on the basis of wave theory. But at the same time, certain phenomena can be explained on the basis of particle theory. So, it's this is known as dual nature of light. Dual means what? Double, two. Yes. So this is this was explained in the modern theory, which is known as quantum theory. Quantum theory of light. Now, quantum theory of light says that light travels in both the ways. Light travels in both the ways depending upon the situation. Depending upon the situation. Now, when we consider quantum theory of light, what does it says? That light has dual nature. Light shows dual nature. Light shows dual nature. That means it shows wave theory also, and definitely it travels and as a particle also. And the different phenomena can be explained on the basis of the different theory. Different phenomena can be explained on the basis of the different theory. Now here, in this chapter, we will be discussing first of all with the term reflection. We will be discussing first of all the term reflection, and we will talk about reflection in detail. And we will also be talking about refraction, not in detail, but still we'll be talking about the refraction also. But other phenomena like diffraction and polarization, we won't be discussing at present now. And so this was about the nature of light. So first of all, we have discussed how we are able to see the objects. When the light falls on any object, it gets scattered, it gets reflected, it bends and moves in other direction, which falls in our eyes and we are able to see. And we also studied about the nature of light, and we understood that the light has got dual nature. Now we will be talking about the term reflection. Now we'll learn more about reflection. What is reflection? So please note all this so that we can move to the next topic. Now we'll talk about reflection. So let me write the heading reflection. We are talking about now reflection. Now, what is the meaning of reflection, and how can we define the term reflection? Whenever a ray of light, falls on any object, children, three things can happen. What can happen? Whenever a light falls on a substance, three things can happen. First of all, the light can pass as it is. The light can pass as it is through that object. Second thing, it can be absorbed by the object. And the third thing which can happen is reflection. So what are the three things which can happen? The first is transmission. The first thing which can happen is transmission. Simply it will pass completely. Second thing, absorption. And the third thing is reflection. Now, most of the time, all three things takes place simultaneously. It is another thing that one is at the higher level and the other is at the lower level. What do I mean to say is, now whenever, now take the example of the window glass. when the light falls on the window glass and we are standing in front of the window glass, sometimes or many a times we are able to see ourselves, but that that is not a clear image. We cannot see us very very clearly as we can see in the plain mirror, but yeah, it's correct that we can see ourselves. You know, we can even see in the just if we stand opposite to the television which is switched off and the light is on, we are able to see ourselves. Again, not very clearly, but yes, we are able to see ourselves. So what can be the thing, the why we are able to see? Because transmission is there, light is passing, but then some light is getting reflected also. Sometimes the reflection can be more and sometimes the reflection can be less, but the reflection takes place. Yes, the reflection takes place, the transmission, the absorption takes place, but it depends upon the object on which the light is falling, that how much reflection will take place, how much transmission, or whether it will be absorbed or not, and if it is absorbed, how much will be absorbed. So how can we define, first of all, reflection, the term reflection? And what is it? How can we understand? Now suppose this is an object, this is an object, and a light comes, a ray of light comes and falls on this surface. A ray of light falls on a substance, and what will happen? It will be sent, it will be sent back. And this sending back, we'll be reading many terms children over here, but first of all please try to understand the meaning of reflection. Now when the ray of light comes from a luminous object, when the ray of light comes from a luminous object, it falls on any object which is capable of reflecting, sending back the ray. So what will happen? This ray is coming over here and it is moving, it's traveling in the same direction, and it is sent back. This coming back of the light is known as reflection. So how can we define the term reflection? The process of sending back, what the process of sending back the light is known as reflection. Now, what is reflection? The process of sending back the light rays is known as reflection. Light is coming and it is sent back. This is known as reflection. Now, you know, if we talk about the reflection takes place best from the shiny surface. It takes best, reflection takes place from where? Reflection from where the reflection takes place? Reflection takes place best from the shiny objects. Shiny objects or surface, from the shiny surface. Now take the example of the metal surface. If from the metal surface, the light get reflected. You know, even the tiles, if you talk about the tiles, are nowadays so shiny that the light get reflected and we are able to see our image. But the light also get reflected, and I should say light get reflected best from the plane surface, plane mirror. So it get reflected from the surface of the plane mirror. Now, what has to be done? You know, when I talk the when I'm saying that it get reflected back nicely, it get reflected back from the metal surface. And you know, the best example which can be quoted is silver. The silver metal. Now, silver is the metal from where? That means when the light is sent, when the light falls on the surface of the silver metal, it get reflected back very nicely. And you know, that is the reason that silver is used at the back of the few mirrors, so that the reflection can be increased, it can take place properly. But the thing is that it gets scratched away very soon, very fast, in very few days. So again, on the coating of the silver, again some other coating is also done. Some other coating is also done, maybe of the paints, so that it can prevent the removal of the silver. Now, as we all know that the silver is a metal which is very costly. So in place of silver, aluminium is used. So what is done, children? On the back side of the plane mirror, the coating of this aluminium is done. And even this is protected by the coating of the paint. Now when the light falls on the plane mirror, now it get reflected very nicely, it get reflected back very nicely. So what is the thing which we are talking about here? Here we are talking about the reflection. And what is that? The sending back of light is known as reflection. And now we'll talk about that in this chapter we will be drawing the images also. We'll be discussing about the image formation also. So whenever we'll be discussing image formation, how the mirror will be shown, children, it will be like a straight line with many short and oblique lines at the back. Now this is a mirror. Now this side, the pink side, is the front side of the mirror. Now the pink side is the front side of the mirror. This is the front side of the mirror. And how the back side can be shown? The back side is shown with lot the small and obliques, very short lines, and this is the back of the mirror. And here I can increase it like this. So this is the back side of the mirror. Now we will be discussing a few more things. You know, how and what is how the reflection takes place, and what are the different terms which we will be using definitely in the chapter. But See, one mirrored, this term will be used you know definitely many a times in the chapter, but along with this, one more word which will be used is ray. Whenever the light falls, do you think only light will fall in the single ray? Single ray will fall? No. So, what will happen? A bundle of rays will be there. A bundle of light rays is called as beam. So, what is the meaning of beam, children? A bundle of light rays, that means when many rays will be shown, a bundle of light rays is known as beam. But if we, when we make the images and we show the beam, we show many rays, and if we show many rays, like if I show over here many rays, so what will happen, children? The diagram will become very, very confusing. The diagram will become very, very confusing, and so to avoid that, generally we take two rays. So, now we will be talking more about this, and we will also be discussing about the how the different terms can be defined. Now, I am saying from when that this ray is coming, but what is this ray known when it falls on any object, on reflecting surface, what does it is, what it is known as? So, now we will be talking about few important terms. And also we will be discussing about that how the terms are used in the in the chapter. Please note this, and now we will be discussing the next point.